Heavenly Father, we give you praise, we give you honor. We thank you, Lord God, for your word. We thank you, Heavenly Father, that Holy Spirit is present to bring us clarity, understanding, and enlightenment of your word. I thank you, Father God, for the transformation that will take place in our lives. Thank you, Heavenly Father, that the seed of the word that's planted in our hearts today will produce fruit in the days, the weeks, the months, and the years to come. And we thank you, Lord God, that we are most blessed because we are your people. In the name of Jesus, amen. 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 Well, if you'll hug a couple of people, take your seats. Praise God. Well, again, we're talking about transition and actually talking about that middle part, the ending of one thing and the developmental part, which we call an emotional wilderness, is where we are at this time. And in thinking about that, you know, again, from last week, I told you that we are responsible for our emotions. We are responsible for our emotions. We can't blame it on other people and things and situations and circumstances, but we ourselves have to take control of our emotions to make sure that they're not pushing us in a place that we do not wish to be. I encourage you to get the message from Wednesday night. If you were not here, you need to listen to that because it talks, Brian talks specifically about being pushed into an area where you could possibly sin because of your emotions. You don't get them in control and it will lead you to sin. So I'm not going to reteach his message because I think he did a wonderful job. So I encourage you to do so. And of course, on last night, Pastor Lamar taught here on Saturday. And I came in and I sat in and I looked at Brian. I said, why is he teaching my message? But I was not inclined to change it. So at any rate, so you may hear a little doubling over, but that's good because the Bible tells us that faith cometh by hearing, not having heard. Amen. So we're talking about this emotional wilderness and how we're going to get out of the emotional wilderness. And of course, we make the decision or we determine how long we are in that particular position. Again, it is a place of development as well. So you're supposed to be learning something through the process. But there are just some things you've got to make ironclad decisions about instead of just kind of wallowing in it and just trying to figure out and bumping into stuff. You've got to make some decisions and some choices yourself. You have to make some resolves and some resolutions concerning how you're going to handle your emotions, how you're going to handle the position that you are in. Let's first turn to Hebrews chapter 11. Hebrews chapter 11. And I have several of these here. We may not get through but one, but it'll be good. Hebrews chapter 11. Hebrews chapter 11, we're going to start at verse 15. However, I want you to understand what's happening above this. Paul is talking to the church, or writing a letter, talking to them about faith and what faith is. And so he begins to talk to them a bit about, you know, Abraham's faith. He talks about Abel's faith. He goes on and he gives about Noah's faith. And then he comes to this point here in verse 15. And it says, and truly, this is a King James, if they had been mindful of that country from whence they came out, they might have had opportunity to return. The Amplified says, if they had been thinking with homesick remembrance of that country from which they were immigrants, they would have found constant opportunity to return to it. So here he's talking about making a resolve of, I won't go back. I won't go back. We just sang the song about I'm moving forward. And then we don't need to go back to relive, or we don't need to be dreaming and daydreaming about the past and how it was and how you liked it. Because, you know, the children of Israel, they were talking about, you know, we had leeks, and they were talking about the fine foods they had. Now, we all know they were slaves. They probably served the fine food, but they weren't eating any of it. But your imagination will make you think that it was better in your past than it was in your, or it's going to be in your future. Yeah. So you have to make a resolve. I'm not going to go back. I'm not going to be longing and homesick about, you know, different things. When we first moved here in this particular building, we did have some people who still were on 56th Street. I wish we could do like we did, Pastor Poe. Do you remember when we was on 56th Street? No, I don't even want to remember. I'm looking forward to the new. You know, I've told you often that I don't want to relive not one day in my life, even the best day. I don't want to relive it. I'm looking forward to the best days in my future. God's got new things that he wants to show me, new things he wants to tell me. So again, you have to make a resolve that I'm not going to remain, or I'm not going to be looking back, trying to compare my future with my past. So he goes on to say here, verse 16, but the truth is that they were yearning for and aspiring to a better and more desirable country, that is a heavenly one. For that reason, God is not ashamed to be called their God, even to be surnamed their God, the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, for he has prepared a city for them. It says, by faith, Abraham, when he was put to the test, while the testing of his faith was still in progress, had already brought Isaac for an offering. He who had gladly received and welcomed God's promises was ready to sacrifice his only son. And he says, of whom it was said, through Isaac shall your descendants be reckoned. For he reasoned, because we got to find out, why is it that, you know, God, you gave me the promise and looked like it's disappearing, looked like it's going away. What was Abraham possibly thinking? And it says in verse 19, for he reasoned that God was able to raise him up even from among the dead. Indeed, in the sense that Isaac was figuratively dead, potentially sacrificed, he did actually receive him back from the dead. In verse 20, it says, with eyes of faith, Isaac reached far into the future. He reached far into the future. He reached. He reached. See, this is explaining why the people, Isaac, Abraham, Jacob, why they did what they did. They weren't looking to their past. They were reaching towards their future. They were looking. They were grasping on something that God had shown them. Then they started to make a decision, not by their emotions, but what they could see. So they're reaching. Look at somebody and say, you got to reach. You cannot just sit around and say, well, here I am. This is the way it is. God has promised you a future and a hope. And he said, it's not going to happen by osmosis, but you're going to have to reach for it. Look at somebody and tell them again, you got to reach. He said that Isaac, he says here that Isaac looked far into the future, invoking blessings upon Jacob and Esau. He saw what the future held and he reached for it. He says, you know what? I got some sons coming along. I got to make some decisions today for their future tomorrow. I can't just sit around living in my today. Do you actually know, don't you know this, that you're living today based on the decisions that you made in the past? So today you need to live today because your future is ahead of you. You can't get caught up in the now, because if you get caught up in the now, you're going to stand still. Reliving the same day over and over and over again, just like the children of Israel. They kept going around and around and around and around in the same place. So here you have it. You have Isaac. He looked into the future. Then in 22, he says, actuated by faith, Joseph, when nearing the end of his life, referred to the promise of God, looked at what God said, the departing of the Israelites out of Egypt, and gave instructions concerning the burial of his own bones. He said, I see in the future. I'm reaching towards the future. So I'm going to talk to you about the future, not right now. I'm looking into my future. Look at somebody else and say, reach. says in verse 24, aroused by faith when he had grown to maturity and become great, refused to be called the son of Pharaoh's daughter. He wasn't lavishing in the fact that he lived in the palace. He was talking about, I got it going on, and I don't, you know, you all got to, you know, come up yourself. But look at me, I'm not even a part of this, but I've been engrafted in, and they treat me just like I'm royalty. That's not what he did. What he did here, again, he says, and Moses, 24, he says, aroused by faith, Moses, when he had grown to maturity and become great, refused to be called the son of Pharaoh's daughter because he preferred to share the oppression, suffer the hardship, and bear the shame of the people of God rather than have the fleeting enjoyment of a sinful life. He considered the contempt and abuse and shame born from the Christ, the Messiah, who was to come. Now, wait a minute. You talking to, wait a minute now. What'd you say? Moses did what? He says, Moses considered the contempt and abuse and shame the Christ, the Messiah who was to come to be greater wealth than all the treasures of Egypt, for he looked forward and away to the reward. So God opened his eyes so he could see far into the future and see Christ and then make the proper choices. See, some of us can't see no farther than a hand in front of us. That's why we make poor choices. We can't see beyond my president, how I feel, and I'm hurting, and I'm sad, and you made me mad, and they not treating me right. And God says, don't you know you have a future beyond this? You making wrong choices. You basing it on how you feel. I'm not basing my promises on how you feel. I'm basing my promises on Christ Jesus, who has already done it for you, and you need to look beyond what's happening to you today. Look at somebody and say, you better reach. Verse 27, he said, motivated by faith, he left Egypt behind him, being unawed and undismayed by the wrath of the king, for he never flinched, but held staunchly to his purposes and endured steadfastly as one who gazed on him who is invisible. He says, by faith, simple trust and confidence in God, he instituted and carried out the Passover and the sprinkling of the blood on the doorpost so that the destroyer of the firstborn, the angel, might not touch those of the children of Israel. He was making all these decisions based on what he saw in the future. 29, urged on by faith, the people crossed the Red Sea as though on dry land. But when the Egyptians tried to do the same thing, they were swallowed up by the sea. Because of faith, the walls of Jericho fell down after they had been encompassed for 7 days by the Israelites. They looking forward to something. They not looking at what is. He says, prompted on by faith, Rahab, prostitute, was not destroyed along with those who refused to believe and obey because she had received the spies in peace. She was looking to her future. She was looking at not what is and making choices and decisions. Then he goes on to say in verse 32, he says, and what shall I say further? For time would fail me to tell of Gideon, Barak, Samson, Jephthah, of David and Samuel and the prophets. And you know what? You need to put your name right there in the list. He says, who by the help of faith subdued kingdom, administered justice, obtained promises, blessings, closed the mouths of lions. He said, these people did this because they could see. We've been wondering, okay, you know, I read about the people with faith in the word of God. What made them have faith? Was it just them confessing something? They didn't have the Bible like what we have it right now. But they were looking, reaching, allowing God to open their eyes so they could understand and comprehend what is actually happening. What's going on around me? What does my future hold? They were able to make these decisions. Verse 36, it says, others, had to suffer the trial of mocking and scourging and even chains and imprisonment. They were stoned to death. They were lured with temptation, tempting offers to remove their faith. They were, see, people were challenged in with their faith as well. They were sawn asunder. They were slaughtered by the sword. I mean, nobody's not doing that to us now. You know what I mean? It says, while they were alive, they had to go about wrapped in skins of sheep and goats, utterly destitute, oppressed, cruelly treated. And you get mad because your coworker says something bad about you. These people were looking to kill these people. It says in 38, men of whom the world was not worthy, roaming over the desolate places and the mountains and living in caves and caverns and holes of the earth. And all of these, though they won divine approval by means of their faith, did not receive the fulfillment of what was promised. Verse 40 includes us. He says, because God had us in mind. These people endured, saw into the future, made decisions, made hard decisions because they thought about us. They knew, see, they saw far in the future. They could see us. And they were making decisions concerning us. He says, because God had us in mind and had something better and greater in view for us. So that they, these heroes and heroines of faith, should not come to perfection apart from us before we could join them. Before we could join them so that we could follow after them. They looked. And they saw, the scriptures talked about how they searched the scriptures and they knew that Jesus was coming. And it talks about the angels even inquired, what is supposed to happen? What is this? And even the angels said, what is man that you were so mindful of them? What is this thing, God, you got going on with this thing called man? They said they made all these decisions. See, we a lot of times make decisions based upon ourselves, what's going on with me right now, what I want for myself. We're not looking far enough into the future. Look at somebody and say, look again. You need to look again. Glory to God. I read somewhere where they said, someone spoke and said that if you look in the scriptures and you read the scriptures and when you come back, all you see is a man, you hadn't looked deep enough. Okay. If all you see is you being natural man, you hadn't looked deep enough. If you look in the scriptures and you don't see yourself the way God sees you, you need to keep looking. You need to keep reaching. You hadn't seen deep enough. You hadn't inquired enough concerning who you are and who Christ has called you to be. Let's look at Numbers chapter 15. I want you to understand that in getting through this and moving through an emotional wilderness, that God is not surprised and astonished and in shock about what's happening to you. God is not bewildered. He's not wondering what just happened. God is not surprised. Numbers chapter 15. Verse 41. In the Amplified, he says, I am the Lord your God who brought you out of the land of Egypt to be your God. I am the Lord your God. The Message Bible says that I brought you out of Egypt to be your personal God. I am God, your God. He said, I brought you out of a particular situation to show you that I'm your personal God. Amen. That means that when you are in an emotional wilderness, when you're in development, God said, this is the time I become real personal with you. Because nobody else can help you out of this. No one else can get you out of this. You can't pay your way out of this. You can't think your way out of this. You can't plan your way out of this. You can't look in your past and pull something from your past and get out of this. He said, now I'm going to show you that I'm going to be your personal God. I'm the God of all people, but I'm going to be your person. We're going to get close. We're going to rub up against one another. You want to get out of this? Start talking to me a little bit more. Start praising me a little bit more. Start looking deeper into the scriptures and start seeing who I say you are. Not what man say you are. Find your identity in me. Stay in close proximity with me. I want to be your personal God. Hallelujah. God is so good. Psalms 34. Psalms 34. Psalms 34. We're going to look at verse 4 in the Amplified. And it reads, this is David. He says, I sought, inquired of the Lord, and required him of necessity and on the authority of his word. And he heard me and delivered me from all my fears. David said, I inquired. I got close to God. I sought him as a vital necessity. David said that I didn't put anything else before him. I didn't try to call all my prayer partners. He said, what I did is I started to seek God as a vital necessity. It was like my life is on the line. I got to get to God. I got to get to Jesus. I got to turn off the radio. I got to put down Facebook, put down Facebook, put down Facebook. I got to turn some stuff off. Because I need God more than I've ever needed him before. Because I'm in this wilderness and I'm wandering around. And he's the only one who sees my future. He's the only one can bring it clear, make it clear to me what it is and where it is and which way I'm supposed to be going. Glory to God. So he said, you have to require of him a vital necessity. And sometimes, yes, God may tell you to go on a fast. Some of y'all don't fast, so we declare a fast in this church. Won't even cross your mind. God say fast, you think it's a faster. Go faster. God surely didn't tell me to fast. It's not January. But David said, I inquired him. It was a vital necessity to me to do so. And he said, when I did, he delivered me from all my fears. He delivered me from all my fears. I know some of y'all hear that and y'all say, oh, he settled all of my problems. And you know what? I got all the money that I needed. And you know, everything is just hunky-dory with me now. I know he said, I settled all your fears. He said, everything you were afraid of. No, you don't have to be afraid of it anymore. No, you don't have the money right now, but I'm not in fear. I know God is going to provide. Do you all understand what I'm saying? Sometimes we read stuff in the scripture that's just not there. He said, I delivered you from all of your what?
Fears.
No longer fear. See, when you walk in fear, you will walk in faith. And then you can trust God to do it even if you don't see it. Glory to God. So you're going to have to make a resolve that you're not going to go back. You got to understand that God is not surprised and he is ready to aid you and assist you, deliver you from all your fears. So even in your emotional wilderness and in your development, you're not afraid of anything. But you are most confident in God. And what you have to do also is locate God. In order for God to give you confidence, you got to see what God sees. And I call it, you need to locate God. Let's go to John chapter 6. John chapter 6. Because you got to see what God is seeing. God, what do you see? God, what do you think? A lot of times when our emotions are all riled up, we can't see. We can't see for the tears. We can't see for the complaining. We can't see for the crying. We can't see because we got everybody in our ears telling us how to do it, what they did. And you know, this is my testimony. And I don't have a testimony, but this is what I think. How many of you know that you need to know something?
Amen.
John chapter 6. And let us start at verse 26. This is after Jesus has fed the 5,000 and they're looking for him. In verse 26, it says, Jesus answered them and said, verily, verily, I say unto you, ye seek me not because you saw the miracles. In other words, you saw the work of God, but because ye did eat of the loaves and were filled. Then he says in verse 27, labor not for the meat which perishes, but for that meat which endureth unto everlasting life, which the Son of Man shall give unto you, for him hath God the Father sealed. So he's saying, okay, I see y'all following me and looking for me, but you're only looking for me because I gave you some free food. You didn't look deep enough to see that God was moving. All you know is they passed the basket around. You got your fill and now you good. And now I'm hungry again. Where's Jesus? And a lot of people are like that. Man, you know, I'm going to go to church because I heard that them people at church, see, whatever they doing, they throwing money on the steps, or, you know, they come up and they say something over them and then things work well for them. So I'm going to go over there because what I'm doing is not working. In actuality, all I want is the stuff I want, and wherever I can get it from, that's where I go. So when it don't work in the church, because that's not how God is, then you go somewhere else and get you some kind of financial planner, whatever it is you do. I'm going to go. They having a seminar over here on how to build wealth. So let me just run over here, because the people in that church over there, they don't know how to build wealth. Just get me out of the situation I'm in so I can have the stuff I want. That's why they was looking for Jesus. He said, you're not looking for me because you saw the hand of God move. You looking for me because you want some stuff. Just stay right on into that emotional wilderness. He says, then said they unto him, what shall we do that we might work the works of God? Jesus answered and said unto them, this is the work of God, that you believe on him whom he hath sent. You want to do what he said? Believe on Jesus. The Amplified says, verse 29, Jesus replied, this is the work. Service that God asks of you, that you believe in the one whom he has sent, that you cleave to, trust, rely on, and have faith in his messenger. Therefore, they said to him, what sign, I'm reading out of the Amplified, what sign, miracle, wonder work will you perform? So that we may see it and believe and rely on and adhere to you, what supernatural work have you to show what you can do? So now, Jesus, show us something. You know, there's a lot of people show up at church. Show me something. Let's have a show. God is supernatural. He's not dealing with the spectacular. And that's what a lot of people are looking for. But he goes on, you know, Jesus is patient. He says, then they say this to him, our forefathers ate the manna in the wilderness, and the scripture says he gave them bread out of heaven to eat. Listen to Jesus' response. Jesus then said to them, I assure you most solemnly, I tell you, Moses did not give you the bread from heaven. What Moses gave you was not the bread from heaven, but it is my Father who gives you the true heavenly bread. He says, for the bread of God is he who comes down out of heaven and gives life to the world. In other words, he was saying that was a temporary thing. He was just filling their stomachs. I am the bread of life. I'm the one who really gives life to people. You're still looking at the natural. You're still looking at how you can be satisfied. He said, but Jesus came to bring you life. I'm the real life. I'm the bread of life. You need to cleave to me. You need to look at me. He goes on to say, then they said to him, Lord, give us this bread always, all the time. Jesus replied, I am the bread of life. He said, I'm it. I'm it. Seek. Require of me. Believe in me. Believe in what I did for you. Believe that when I came and I died and I rose again and you accepted the gift of salvation, he said, believe, I brought you grace. I'm the one who calls you to have favor with God. Look, you need to believe on what I did concerning you. and your relationship with God. Again, a lot of people just looking at their creature comforts. God, you know, just I just need a newer car. I need this. I want that. Actually, you just looking at what other people got and wanting it. We'll leave that alone for another message. You need to have mentors in your life that helps you through emotional wilderness. Now, listen, a lot of times people choose mentors in the wrong way. They choose mentors sometimes because they want what they have. But a mentor is determined by their character, their mental and moral qualities. Not because they're perfect, but they have a perfect heart towards God. They're willing to admit when they're wrong. Mentors. My mentor is Pastor Taffy. I told her, I said, you probably don't even know it. I said, I draw from you a lot. And even in my most difficult times, she seemed not to even deal with it. How many of you notice that when Jesus is talking to people, they'd ask a question, and it seemed like he'd be off the wall talking about something. He said, or either they didn't ask a question, and he said, and they answered him. It's like, Jesus, did you hear the question that was just asked? And now you talking about, what you talking about, Jesus? He's telling them the necessary thing. Yes. And see, that's what a mentor will do. I can remember during 9/11, I think I may have shared this with you before, but 9/11, Greg was out of the country. It appeared that he seemed to have been out of the country during hurricanes and any, you know. I told him, how is it that you manage that? And then he calls me to tell me what I ought to be doing. But nonetheless, and he couldn't get back because, you know, they weren't allowing you to fly. And he was in the Ukraine. And, of course, he's trying to figure out what's happening and not halfway knowing. But it happened on a Tuesday, as you know. And we had Bible study in St. Petersburg. And I was supposed to go over and teach. And so I'm sitting on my bed watching these planes, and I'm thinking, okay, now, God, what are we going to do? Well, you know, I came, talked to the staff and did all of that, but I'm thinking about, you know, so what do we do about this Tuesday night service we're having in St. Petersburg? And you know, Pastor Poe, you don't cancel nothing. Everything is on. So I call her, and I, you know, Pastor Taffy Greg, and she was like, oh, really? She has such a, you know, spoonful of sugar when you're getting medicine type deal. She's, oh, really? I said, yes. And, you know, we're trying to get him back over. And, you know, we can't. And I've already been teaching for going on 3 weeks now. You know, I think I'm just, you know, I'm just going on and on. She said, She said, okay, so what airline is he on? I'm telling her, she said, uh-huh. So, Deborah, what you teaching tonight? I looked at the phone. I thought to myself, did she hear what I just said? Did she hear me say I've been preaching already for about 3 weeks and I already had my mental capacities and all my messages and already, and I'm at the end of this series of messages and you want to ask me what? No, you're supposed to be helping me get my husband back over here. That's why I called you. And I said, I got to look at a few things. She said, well, yeah, what time is the service starting? It was like, you don't have much time. You need to get with God. See, that's what I'm talking about. Mentors, they not slapping you on, high-fiving you and, you know, telling you how good you are. They look at what is necessary and talk to you from that capacity. Let's look at John chapter 5. I think this will help you. John chapter 5. John chapter 5. And this is, you know, you made your best buddy. You say, you know, I'm, you know, because it matters. The people that you associate with, it truly matters. And I was thinking about the children of Israel when they came out of Egypt. And you know how they wandered around in the wilderness all those years, and they weren't that far from the promised land. And we understand that two of them were able to go into the promised land. That was Caleb and Joshua. But don't you know Caleb and Joshua were with those other people wandering around also? Because they were with the group. Although they believed God, they were with the group, associating with a group of people who were complaining and murmuring and just not satisfied with nothing God did. They had to wander around with them those same number of years. So how many people you attached to got you wandering around in a wilderness that you could get out of if you just disassociate with them? Just food for thought. John chapter 5. Did I say verse 44? And I'm going to read this out of the Amplified. But again, you don't choose your best buddy and people who just agree with you and always there just, you know, okay, you did good, I did good. Y'all high-fiving each other. Look at what the word says. He said, how is it possible for you to believe? How can you learn to believe? You who are content to seek and receive praise and honor and glory from one another, and yet do not seek the praise and honor and glory which come from him who alone is God. Yes. So we seek out for people to pat us on the back and say, you did a good job, and say, you know, they my best friend because they always encouraging me. God has so many awesome things that he has prepared for us. And he's asking us to reach for them. He's asking us to get in places where our emotions don't control us, where we don't make decisions based on our present, but we make our decisions based on our future. And not the future you created, but the future God has for you. And again, we can look at the scriptures, and the Bible tells us in Jeremiah, that he has a plan for our life, and it's a good plan. But don't you know nobody can tell you that plan? You have to be seeking God and asking him where is it he is taking you? Where does he want you to go? Because at one while here, I asked God, okay, so what are we doing? Some of this just don't seem fair to me. And I was talking specifically about me teaching. Because I was always, you know, Greg, whatever you want me to do, I want to do it. Let me help you out. And he was like, oh, okay. So I remember when he asked me to go and teach over in Brandon. And I said, oh, okay, yeah, I'll go in the morning teach at Brandon. Then he said, yeah, and I'm, you know, teaching the two services here on Sunday. So why don't you leave Brandon and drive over to St. Petersburg and teach over there too? And I said, well, yeah, okay, I'll do that. Then he changed his service to 1. Okay. I'm gonna leave because, you know, I live almost in Lutz. Lutz drive to Brandon, then leave Brandon drive to St. Petersburg. And I get up in the morning because I gotta leave early. And you sipping coffee. Okay. I can do that. You know, I really could have entered into some kind of emotional, what's this all about? And I almost did, but then I figured I was in a developmental. God must be doing something, right? Okay, so then, you know, we decided to bring Brandon over here, and I'm in St. Petersburg, and then he says, hey, look, why don't you go to Wesley Chapel? What, God? Wait. Now, I know you all didn't know all that was happening, but do y'all know I actually would leave church and go home and prepare dinner for my family as well. And Gray would come home and say, man, I'm so tired. And while I finished up dinner, he laid down. just saying. And then I resolve, okay, God, you are preparing me for something. And thus he was. But there were times when it was like, huh, wait, what? Or I'll teach on a Sunday. And then Greg would tell me while I'm at work on Wednesday, why don't you teach y'all the Wednesday night service? Gotcha. So I would leave work. And thankfully, I read and I study and I'm, you know, listening at what he's saying. And then we get up on Thursday and I'll say, you know, you got the seniors. He go, oh, yeah, that's right. Could you just go in and what? And why don't you catch Saturday also? Okay, I got that. I'm going to keep teaching on Sundays and I'm going to keep doing this and I'll keep cooking on Sundays. But during the week when he called me and say, what are we going to eat? You know what I said? You mean, where are we going to eat? Because I just preached. I cleaned. I washed. I went to the grocery store. I picked up your dry cleaning when you asked me to. And you're on the golf course and you all understand, but it's all in how you see it. It's all in what you are. If you can see through God's eyes and see past your future, then you don't let your emotions get involved here to stop you up from doing what God is telling you to do, because he has a future and a hope for you. You have to see past. Look at somebody and say, you better reach.
You better reach.
Because I know people like, is she okay? Are you all right? I am perfectly fine. I guarantee you. Because I have been prepared. Because not only I was reaching, but I thank God Greg was reaching also. And insisting that I do the things necessary so I would be prepared for today. And yes, I'm getting, you stand by yourself? Yeah. Already, Deborah? Yeah. Are you sleeping well? Yeah. Do you see what I mean when you look past the now? When you don't get all upset and frustrated with now. And the only way you can do it is you got to look. You got to look through the eyes of God. You got to get close to him. You got to make some decisions that I won't go back. That the old is not better. But my future is better. My future is bright. And I'm looking forward to all that God wants to use me for and do through me. And I thank God for the Holy Spirit coming in and arresting me when I wanted to do stuff that was off the wall. When I wanted to complain. God is a good God. Look at somebody else and say, you better reach. If you gonna survive, you better reach. Glory to God. Heavenly Father, we just give you praise. We give you honor. We thank you for the power of your word to change our lives. I thank you, Heavenly Father, that the word that has been taught this morning will be internalized. I thank you, Lord God, that it will find itself in deeply rooted into our hearts and into our spirits. Thank you, Heavenly Father, that we no longer will wonder what you're doing. But Father, we will have the confidence to know that you know what you are doing. And we just give you all the praise and we give you all of the honor. In the name of Jesus, amen. If there's anyone here today and you're not born again, you don't know Jesus as your Lord and personal Savior, this is an awesome opportunity for you. I tell you, God is such a good, good God. He's a good God all the time. And he is watching over his word to perform it. He is seeking out those who inquire of him and require of him a vital necessity so he can show himself strong in your lives. so that you can be an example for others that God is a good, good God. So if that's you and you're not born again, but you'd like to be, if you'll please raise your hands wherever you are. Praise God. If there's anyone here today and the Lord has laid upon your heart to join Revealing Truth Ministries, I believe that if that's what he's doing, then you have an anointing, a talent, a gifting on the inside of you that's good for this part of the body of Christ. I believe that the word that's being taught here and the people that are here to encourage you, here to stir you up, here to push you on to carry out the perfect will of God in your life. So if that's you this morning, if you'll please raise your hand, if God has laid upon your heart to join Revealing Truth Ministries. Praise God. Amen.